so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. So glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high.
Come rest your spirits in the Lord. You come hungering and thirsting for God's word. This is a place of peace and hope where all may be fed and healed. Bring us to the time of healing. Come place your trust in God, who is always near you. Open your hearts, Lord, to hear your word and fill your presence. Amen. Please join me in the prayer of personal reflection. Lord, we come into your presence this morning With the busy schedules of summer activities crowding our lives, our souls need to be fed, and yet we seem powerless to find nurture and feeding that will sustain us. Open our ears, our eyes, and our hearts this day to hear your words of hope and healing for us. We ask this in Jesus' name.
Amen. Reading from John 6, reading verses 1 through 21. Sometime after this, Jesus crossed to the far shore of the Sea of Galilee, that is, the Sea of Tiberias. And a great crowd of people followed him because they saw the signs he had performed by healing the sick. Then Jesus went up on a mountainside and sat down with his disciples because the Jewish Passover festival was near. When Jesus looked up and saw a great crowd coming toward him, he said to Philip, "Where shall we buy bread for these people to eat?" He asked this only to really test them, for he already had in mind what he was going to do. And Philip answered, "Well, it would take more than a half a year's wages to buy enough bread for each one to have a bite." Just a bite. Another of his disciples, Andrew, Simeon Peter's brother, spoke up. "Here is a boy with 5 small barley loaves and 2 small fishes. But how far will that go among so many?" And Jesus said, "Okay, have the people sit down." There was plenty of grass in that place, and they sat down. About 5,000 men were there. Jesus then took the loaves and gave thanks and distributed to those who were seated as much as they wanted. He did the same with the fish. When they had all they had enough to eat, he said to the disciples, "Gather the pieces that are left over. Let nothing be wasted." So they gathered them and filled 12 baskets with the pieces of the 5 barley loaves left by those who had eaten. And after the people saw the sign Jesus had performed, they began to say, "Surely this is the prophet who is come into the world." Jesus knowing, and I like this part here, Jesus knowing that they intended to come and make him king by force, withdrew again to the mountain by himself. When evening came, his disciples went down to the lake, where they got into a boat and set off across the lake of Capernaum. By now it was dark, and Jesus had not yet joined them. And there was a strong wind was blowing, and the waters grew rough. And when they had rowed about 3 or 4 miles, they saw Jesus approaching the boat, walking on the water, and they were frightened. But he said to them, "It is I, don't be afraid." And then they were willing to take him into the boat, and immediately the boat reached the shore where they were heading. Isn't this an amazing story? Actually, several stories mixed into one. The feeding of the multitude is the only miracle, believe it or not, that is actually told in all 4 Gospels. Now, there are many miracle stories that are told, but not all of them have the same miracles in there. There's a variety, and this is the only miracle story that is in all 4 Gospels. While each Gospel includes this story, I am glad to say that each writer of the Gospel told it a little bit differently than the next. Everybody has their perspective. And only John tells us that this event takes place just around the time of the Passover. That may seem like an insignificant detail, But ultimately, it is an amazing fact that goes to back up all the prophecies that were made in the Old Testament about the coming Messiah. So it had significance. You know, there are several things that I've looked at myself that I've come up with that I've just kind of stood out like little red flags saying, I wonder why this is written in here, or why was that put in there? When you look at the number of 5,000 people mentioned in this text, that does not include women or children. It was only 5,000 men. So actually, when this miracle took place, there was the feeding of a larger multitude than 5,000. We could have added another 4,000 or 5,000 to that. And knowing with lots of children, maybe there was 12,000. We don't even know. But only 5,000 are mentioned because they're men. And then in verse 6, what stands out to me, Jesus asks one of his disciples, how are we going to feed them? I love this. It sounds like my mother. You know, she already knows the answer and what's going to happen, but she asked the question anyway. How are we going to feed all these people? And it was kind of one of those test questions, like, do you really know? And maybe it was really asking, do you really know me? And what I am able to do? Did they really believe that Jesus could handle the situation? Or was he going to look like a fool? But it was a test question. Another thing that stands out to me is after the large crowd had eaten, Jesus requested that all the leftovers be gathered up. Now, I don't know about you, but I love leftovers. I don't know if I would have loved a leftover raw fish, but I will tell you, I do like leftovers. And here they get 12 basketful of leftovers. The interesting part to that is, I wanted to know what he did with them. Did he give them to the poor in the city? What did he do with them? Maybe he went back with the disciples and had their own banquet. Or maybe he took them to the mountaintop when he was wanting to be alone and he had food to eat there. That would have been one of my questions maybe I would have liked to have had an answer for. But we don't know. But I know one thing, because he didn't want to waste them, they obviously were put to good use. Whatever he did with those. And then another thought comes to mind. After the miracle of bread and fish, Jesus realizes as he's looking at this crowd, now they're all fed and full and feeling good, and they realize that Jesus has done this unusual, extravagant miracle of feeding thousands of people. What comes in their mind? I don't know if they were so excited about the fact that it was a miracle, but I think they began to see that this guy, this Jesus here, that has done all of this, should be our king. Let's make him king, because if he knows how to do all of this stuff, we're going to be taken care of forever. Let's make him king. He knows how to do this. He knows how to work every situation. Let's make him king. And then the thing that stands out to me is Jesus sees this, his eyes are opened, and he realizes, but this is not what I came to do. I didn't come to be the king. What does Jesus do? He goes up into the mountainside, kind of hides away, doesn't want to be king. And then further down in this story, as we get closer to verses 19, 18, in that area, we see the disciples getting into a boat, and they're starting to go across the river. Jesus is not with them, and a turbulence starts. The wind begins to blow. What's amazing with me is here they had just eaten, served thousands with Jesus. And the only thing that comes into mind, it must have been pretty dark. But all of a sudden in the distance, they see a figure coming towards them. And they're afraid. At first, they can't see who it is. And they become very fearful, and Jesus senses that. And he said, "It is I." And once they heard his voice, they knew who it was. My question to that is, I'm amazed, and there are so many other stories in the New Testament where Jesus walks on the road to Emmaus and they don't know him, maybe because of the resurrection. There are times Jesus gathers at a table, and it's not until he breaks the bread and speaks do they realize it's him. Sometimes I wonder how often that we don't look into the eyes of Jesus and see him in the works of other people and in places, and we don't even realize it's him. You know, John paints a very different picture for us of the feeding of this huge crowd. In the first part of his story, they're all happy and they're delighted because now they're being fed. They came hungry and looking for something. And now they're fed, they're being taken care of. And as a result of that, being physically accommodated, they turn their eyes and they begin to see Jesus as their king. This is too good a story to be true. Jesus obviously will take care of us, will love us, and whatever. Here is the happy time of getting to know Jesus. Oh, we all want the happy time of getting to know Jesus, and we want the miracles, and we want the blessings, and we want the bread to be divided and the fish to be divided, and everybody have enough. But then not long after this wonderful event of being fed, John talks about another traumatic story, a miracle that actually happens, but it's of a different nature, different tone, different feeling. The disciples are in the boat and they're afraid. The storm has picked up, the winds have picked up. They're not secure because Jesus is no longer with them. And I don't know that they had enough faith on their own to believe. And here Jesus comes walking towards them. I wonder if they had gone back to their old belief system and thought, oh, maybe here's Neptune coming and he's going to take our lives and destroy us. But then Jesus walks over. It is I. Don't be afraid. Here were Jesus' own disciples, terrified of their own lives, that somehow it was going to end. It was not any more flocking around the large crowd and feeding the hungry and seeing the joy of everybody being full. It was a frightening, devastating experience. When I think of these two stories, I think how different they are. And why would John have even put them together? Now, we know that they happened in an order, and that happened within a day. But why does he concentrate on these two stories? Maybe because it represents our lives. Do we always live on the side of life where we're being taken care of and fed? All our needs are being met. We feel good. We're satisfied. We're not hungry. All of those things are a good thing. Miracles are happening every day. I'm just so content. Yes, Jesus is a part of that part of our lives too. And miracles can happen in those good times. They do. But then John takes us a step forward and says, but Jesus and the miraculous also happens when you're afraid. When you're in that time of fear, uncertainty, and you don't know what is going to happen tomorrow or what's going to come out of this event or a health situation or somebody's in the hospital or whatever, and you don't know what's going to happen, does that God abandoned you during those times? And here John says, oh no, he doesn't. He not only takes care of you and feeds you, but in those moments of distress and uncertainty and trial and tribulation, he is there. You know, William Williamson, he's a commentator that often writes about different scriptures, and I look at many of them to kind of glean from their point of view. And this was a comment that he made about this text. He said, in my church these days, we have almost exclusively focused on Jesus as the one that feeds us, loves us, heals us. And we are almost completely oblivious to the negativity of life. And that in the negativity, Jesus saves us. We forget so much that Jesus has the possibility to save us in those crippling moments of life. You know, we as Americans and even human beings, but I think sometimes more so American, we tend to be very self-sufficient. I can do it. I know how to do it. I can do it myself. We're self-satisfied. We're people that go out and we buy what we want. We purchase what we want. We get all the things that delight us and fill us and satisfy us. But we don't often think we need saving. We can do it. We can make it. But there are times in our lives where I truly believe God needs to come in and rescue us. Maybe even from ourselves. I think sometimes we are our worst enemy because we don't think well of ourselves or we think too much of ourselves, whatever it may be. And Jesus has to come in and wake us up to help us to recognize that there is a difficulty, a trauma, a situation in our lives, and he needs to save us. And we can't do it alone. When I first read these two stories, I kept thinking, why did John weave these two together? And here I also see that Jesus really didn't want to become king. He wanted to be a servant, and he wanted to be a savior. He wanted to free us from the things that control us and bind us. You know, more than ever, I think these two stories go together because they map out our lives the way they really are. There are times in our lives we have joy, we have laughter, we are filled, we have more than enough. But then there are times in our lives when we're in the boat and the waves are high and the winds are blowing and we don't know where we're going to land. And he needs to save us. It is I. It is me. Here I am. Amen.
Singing next in the garden, that would be hymn 200 in your hymnals. Come to the garden alone, and the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God is close. Of all his
got two more. I'll fly away. That would be him. I don't know if it's in the hymn. It may be, just one second. What's your next choice? Greatest thy faithfulness. I believe that is in here. What number? 48. Okay, great is thy faithfulness. First and third, yes. Was that Pat? 51.
Yes.
And we'll have one more after this. We'll do verses 1 and 3 of On Eagle's Wings. Upon eagle's wings, there you are. One more. What? 5:53. We're going to call the roll this morning.
And the trumpet of the Lord shall sound, and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal, bright and fair. And the saved lovers shall gather over on the other shore, and the roll is called of yonder over there. When the roll is called of yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called of yonder, I'll be there.
God, how grateful we are for your listening ear, for your open arms to us, for the many circumstances in our lives, but yet you are here. May we recognize you. May we feel your presence and your touch in our lives. We pray for those that have been mentioned this morning, Mike Metcalf, Patty and Ed and Marcia. Lord, we pray for our nation, and we pray for St. John's. We pray for those needs that are on our hearts that we were not able to mention this morning, but you know them. You know how difficult they are to even speak of, and you know them. So we give them to you when we lay them at the foot of the cross today, knowing that you will hear us and you will answer according to your will. God, we thank you for all that you do and for the many praises that we have, for the many miracles that happen in our lives every day. And we also pray the prayer that you taught your disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed it be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. That's a wonderful song that we've been singing all month long. I almost hate to give it up. I just love that song. It just seems to end the service in a certain frame of mind that we can't go out into the world alone. It's only with Christ and his love. So go with the love of God. Go with his peace. And be the love of Christ to those around you. Amen.